Guys, this is Connor at Conquest HP, and this is my ultimate video guide to the squat, the exercise. So first of all, why should you care? Why should you squat? What makes this a worthwhile exercise in the first place? You are going to be hard pressed to find another exercise that works as much muscle as thoroughly as the squat. It develops virtually everything in the legs, including glutes, quads, hamstrings. You get calf work out of it. Done with proper form, it's really good reinforcement for low back muscles, for the lats and the muscles that support the upper back. And you'll even get a small training effect for the upper back and back of the shoulders. So it's virtually a full body exercise. Beyond that, beyond just the muscle that you're working, squatting through whatever is a full range motion for you represents a great energy expense. So if you are dieting, if you're trying to burn through as much energy as possible to help with the diet, help lose fat or build muscle, squatting is going to be a great gift to you, as well as those kind of more aesthetic concerns. Squatting is something you have to do all day, every day anyways. If you're getting yourself into and out of chairs, you're using a squat. If you're sitting down on the toilet, that's a squat. If you're sitting down into the tub, or if you're picking something up off the floor, or playing with a child or a dog, it's going to happen. You're going to have to be able to squat. So if you prepare yourself, if you get strong at the barbell squat and squat variations in the gym, it prepares you for all of life. It's useful when hiking, when running, when playing around, when gardening, when doing everything else that makes life good. So the benefits are wide-ranging. There's a whole lot of bang for the buck in one exercise. Now, I know a lot of people watching this video are going to think right away, but the squat isn't safe, or squats hurt your knees, and that's just not really true. Again, you have to do it all the time anyways. You might as well learn to do it well. That would be the safest thing for you. But the idea that squats hurt the knees, that's an old one, and that comes from the fact that if you squat deep, you're moving the knee through a full range of motion. And as a fully grown adult, most of us will lose that full range of motion. We'll get tight hips and a tight back and weak muscles, and we won't be able to get that deep range of motion that we need for a good squat. And trying to get there is going to cause some knee pain, because the older you get, usually the more deconditioned your knees and your muscles get, the more susceptible to stress your joints get. So is the squat dangerous for the knees? If the dosage is on point, like if you're not, if you're pushing yourself, but not pushing yourself so hard that you're going to have tissue breakdown that you can't repair, you're safe. And if your form mitigates basic risk factors, you're safe. So in other words, if you approach the squat gradually, you build up your tolerance to it over time, and you're always on top of your form, and you're smart with your dosages, it is not only perfectly safe, it'll make you far more resilient against injury and pain in the future. So you do have to squat right for your own body, though, for your own type. There are large anatomical differences from person to person. Some of them we can get around, some of them we can't. Some people have longer femurs in relation to their torso. Some people have longer torsos in relation to their femurs. It's not all the same. And hip anatomy can vary quite a bit. The width of the hip, the depth of your actual hip socket changes dramatically from person to person. The angling of the socket, where the socket sits on the hip bone, changes from person to person. The shape of the actual femur that goes into the hip bone, that changes from person to person. So what does all that stuff mean? It just means that if I'm squatting next to my next door neighbor, one of us is going to probably have a hip that's better set up for a deep squat than the other person. That's just the way it works. It's not an excuse. You should do everything you can to build your mobility and your active range of motion. But you need to accept at some point that there are anatomical limitations to how far you can go. That doesn't mean that you don't squat entirely. It just means that for some people with a particular shape and form of their hips are going to be able to squat with a really narrow stance, like shoulder width or closer, and they're going to be able to do it and get really deep. See, I'm fairly good at that. I have good hips for squatting. Some people will be most comfortable with that narrow stance, but they're only ever going to get to just above parallel. And if they try to go any deeper than that, they have to round the back. That's not a good trade-off. At that point, we are risking our health with our technique. So again, rather than saying don't squat, what I would say to that person is go through that range of motion as deep as you can before your form breaks down. That is your working range of motion. Don't worry about it any more than that. Try to expand it if you can. But if you can't expand it with good form that mitigates injury risk, then don't do it. Just work with what you have. And also, different pelvis, different shape of hip capsules, that kind of thing. Some people might be more comfortable with a wide stance squat. I've had some people that if you take them through a narrow stance squat, they're only going to get halfway down. If you take them to a wide stance squat outside of shoulder width, they can get almost all the way to parallel. Again, not everyone will be able to do that, and the opposite will also be true. The person that's really good at squatting with a narrow stance might be terrible at a wide stance squat. You just have to experiment, play around with the techniques, find out what you are most comfortable with. And whatever you can repeat most over time is going to be the variation that helps you the most. So it's tempting to say you're bad at a narrow stance squat. So that's where you're going to see the most development, working on your weakness. But if every time you do a narrow stance squat, it puts you in an awkward position and you tweak your back, or it makes your knees really achy. Whereas if you went to a wide stance squat, you can do that all day, every day, and you're never going to have an ache or a pain. Just wide stance squat. If you still want to do the narrow stance, do it from time to time, load it really lightly, go really easy on it, save most of your heavy work for that wide stance squat. It's that simple. Okay, so you have to play around with your positions. So that's where I would urge most of you to start, even just to play around with extremes so you can get an idea of what's actually going on. Start with your feet within shoulder width, or within hip width, sorry. So feet maybe just a few inches apart and pointing straight ahead. Now see how deep you can squat there. So again, I'm a pretty decent squatter range motion wise, but if I set up that way, yeah, I think I'm gonna start to lose my back position there. If I do the same thing, but I turn my feet out a little bit, like 30 degrees, well, I can get a little deeper. So start there and then compare it to like a sumo squat with your feet really turned out and like twice as wide as shoulder width and see how that feels. For me, that feels pretty tight. It's not feeling too natural. But one or the other might feel better to you right away. And what I would have you do is start with that narrow stance, do a couple squats there, observe how it feels. If there's anything tight, observe that as well. If you feel particular muscles working, pay attention. Move out a couple inches. Move each foot out an inch, 2 inches. Do the same thing there. Hit a couple bodyweight squats. How does that feel? Better, worse, indifferent? Move out a couple more inches. Do the same thing. Is it feeling better, worse? Make notes on all of this. And continue that until you get out to really wide. So at some point, this is going to start feeling better and then worse again. And when you figure out what feels best for you, you found the variation that you're probably going to want to use the most in the gym for most of your workouts. The wider you go, the more you can safely turn your feet out. So if I'm really narrow, I'm going to want my feet almost straight ahead. If I have shoulder width, I'm going to probably want to be within 30 degrees or less of foot turn. If I go really wide, then I'm going to be pushing that 30 degrees, 40 degrees kind of thing. Again, that'll be a personal preference, but play around with it as well. The most important thing with your foot position is that your knee tracks over top of your feet. So if I have a big outward turn in my feet when I squat, that's all right if my knees are moving over top of my feet still. If I get to the point where I've turned my feet up quite a bit and my knees are not moving over top of my feet, there's a much greater risk of injury to the knee. It's not going to strain the glutes as well. It's probably going to put a little more strain on the back, that kind of thing. So we probably want to avoid that. So as a general rule of thumb, try to keep the knee moving over top of a plane that would have it over top of the second toe or the big toe. Generally speaking, that'll keep you safe regardless of your foot positioning. And it's okay if you have a slight discrepancy from side to side. If you don't have your feet perfectly aligned, if you find that your right foot wants to angle out just a little bit more, you can have discrepancies in hip anatomy from one side to the other. So if I say your feet have to be perfectly aligned the whole time, textbook straight ahead all the time, that might cause you pain. That might limit your mobility. It might limit your strength. It might wear out one hip faster than the other. So pay attention to how it feels when you're doing it. And if one foot always kind of edges to turning out a little bit more, play with that. If it feels good, if the muscles are still developing fairly evenly, you're not getting any painful imbalances or tight tissues that won't go away or pain, just go with it. You don't have to be textbook by the book all the time because human beings aren't textbook. In terms of the actual grip that you use on the bar, so generally speaking, if I'm using a back squat, the closer I can get my hands to my shoulders, the more stability I'm going to have in my upper back. So if I grab a bar here, so you'll see people with really bad shoulder mobility doing a back squat with their hands all the way out to the outside. Now, you'll do this to reduce elbow pain, shoulder pain, that kind of thing. But this is telling me that the shoulders are not mobile enough to come all the way in. See, if I can get them all the way in, my upper back is naturally really tight. And then from here, I can pull my shoulder blades back and down, and my upper back won't move at all. Now, the wider out I go, the harder it becomes to pull down with my elbows. The harder it becomes to pull my shoulder blades back and down. So even if I try, I'm not going to have that same stability in the upper back, and I might waver a little bit. So go as close to the shoulders with your grip as you can. If going in really far hurts wrists, elbows, whatever, pay attention to that. If this hurts, but going out an inch further doesn't hurt, honor that, work with that. Again, you can try to increase your mobility as you go, but you have to work with what's right in front of you right now. Use a grip with your full thumb around the bar if you can, but when you get in really tight, you might find that you have to have your thumb on top of the bar. That's how I squat when I squat really heavy. There's nothing wrong with it. Just make sure you're really squeezing the bar hard when you're doing your squats still. As you're still pulling down really hard, trying to get those shoulder blades in your back pockets. Now, what I have right now is a high bar position. So the bar is above the spines of the scapulae. So the spines or the rigid scapulae is a bone that runs diagonally, kind of horizontally across the upper back. So if I have the bar above that, kind of on my traps, that's high bar. If I go slightly below that into my mid back, that's low bar. most people are going to be stronger low bar, but the mobility demands are much, much greater. So if you have mobility problems to begin with, don't worry about going low bar just yet. Play around with high bar. Do the occasional light set where you're working with a low bar position, but don't worry about it too much for right now. So the other thing is where your elbows should be. Where should they be? I mean, if you have your grip in nice and tight, the idea will be to pull the shoulder blades back and down. I want to try to get my shoulder blades in my back pocket. And immediately that's going to kind of pull my elbows just beneath the bar and a little behind the bar. You're always going to want to work with that cue to pull the shoulder blades back and down. But if you do it here, obviously it's going to bring the elbows into a slightly different position. So just be aware, let your elbows go where they want to go naturally. Focus on getting a tight upper back. So if getting a tight upper back means that your elbows are back behind the bar a little bit instead of right under the bar, that's perfectly fine. You have to go where you're most comfortable. Okay, so the whole thing, you tie everything together, you got your bar placement, tight upper back, the stance, hip width, foot alignment, all that stuff that works best for you. And you're gonna line up in the rack, set it up exactly how you're most comfortable, step it out, and from here, I'm going to fill my stomach with a bunch of air. So I want to expand my stomach this way, I want to expand my lower back this way. Like I'm wearing a belt around my belly button, and I want to expand that belt 360 degrees. So I'm gonna take a deep breath in and hold it in. So I've just made myself a little bit fat when I do that. Now if I can hold that pressure in while I squat, it means that my lower back will not be able to move anywhere, and that means that my lower back will be safe. So it supports the spine. So stance that you like, bar position you like, tie over back, and then brace. If you're doing more than a couple reps at a time, you want to reset that brace for each rep. The other thing you want to do before you start each rep is either brace really hard and bring air into the stomach, like I just showed you there. It's not actually air going into the stomach, of course. Or just tense your core like someone's going to hit you. You can do that with lighter loads. The closer you get to your one rep max, the more you're going to have to brace. You're always going to want to contract your glutes though. So when I walk that bar out, pick it up, step back, I'm going to fire my glutes as hard as I can in this top position and get my bracing going and try to hold that tension as I go into my squat. Again, work with the range of motion available to you. Go down as far as you can without compromising form, without causing pain, and you'll be maximizing muscle growth, energy burn, strength development, all of those things. And you'll be working with the most functional range of motion as well, because the deepest range of motion you can do safely is the most functional. So those are the basics of squatting. It's going to come down a lot to you as a person, as an individual. Squat right for your type. And if you have questions, definitely leave them in the comments below, or don't be afraid to contact me through ConquestHP or chpconnor@gmail.com. And I'll talk to you guys again soon. Don't forget to hit like and subscribe. I'll do some more videos like this.